I'm Mike Kiser, and I'm the Global Security Advocate from the Office of the CTO at SailPoint Technologies. And it's my pleasure this year at RSA to introduce a session with my good friend Ben about how algorithms need an ethical but a practical ethical approach. Happy to present the session called The Past is Not the Future, Practical Ethics for Algorithms, out in the law track. And our story in this session, what we'll actually be talking about is the case of Tara Simmons. On November 16th, 2017, she found herself sitting before the Washington State Supreme Court. The child of addicts and an ex-addict and an ex-felon herself, she had subsequently graduated near the top of her law school class. The Washington State Law Board had denied her access to the bar, fearing that the old Tara would return. The old addict felon, Tara. She was asking the court to trust her to become an attorney, and the outcome of her case rested on whether or not her past could be used to predict her future. While we are not in the place of Tara today, we find ourselves in a very similar position. Algorithms try to predict everything about us and our future from our past. The assumption often is that with enough data, anything is predictable. Now, over the last several years, however, we've seen headline after headline that have repeatedly illustrated the influence of algorithms on human well-being, along with the inherent biases that affect many of them. Before we rush to embrace artificial intelligence algorithms and the math involved with them, we want to seek to promote justice and fairness rather than just reinforcing already existing inequalities. And to that end, we're building on work from organizations such as IBM and the IEEE and the high-level expert group on artificial intelligence, who have done a fantastic job setting up proposed standards and exploring the ins and outs of different aspects of an ethical approach to algorithms. And what we're trying to do here is build on that foundation, not rework what's already been done, but consolidate what they have and seek to make it practical. So to that end, what we've done, what I've done is I've actually summarized those ethical approaches into these five areas: well-being, accountability, transparency, fairness, and user data rights. And what we do is we examine each of these in turn, and we go about trying to provide a practical framework using practical open source tools that are available on the market today or techniques that are well known to equip organizations to take that next step. From sitting from afar saying, yes, we want to be ethical, we want to know how to approach algorithms well, to equipping them with the tools and the practices to actually make that possible. And then once they undertake this self-evaluation process, what they can start to do is start to show where they are on their ethical journey. In other words, each of these axes can be self-evaluated for how they're doing, how they're approaching well-being, how they're handling user data rights, how accountable they are, et cetera, and then charting that status on what I call an ethical maturity graph. And the reason for this is often when you have these discussions with other people or between algorithm and choices that you're making there, it's tough to have a visualization or a concise view of your ethical approach and the ethics involved. And so the ethical maturity graph tends to give that. This has a couple of advantages. It lets you see progress over time. Maybe you want to expand out in the transparency direction, showing your users and your clientele the transparency of your algorithms while you're making those decisions with algorithms and explaining it well. Or maybe some other axis, and you can actually see where you're weak and seek to advance in those areas. And you can snapshot at different times and see that progress as you're making that from year to year and decade to decade. And not only does it self and internal evaluation take place, but you can also interact with other people using algorithms and artificial intelligence and machine learning and the like, and see how their ethical approach is faring. Find people whose strengths are your weaknesses. Talk to them about their approach, what's worked, what hasn't worked, what tools are you using, how they're self-evaluating, how they're navigating their own internal politics. The idea here is giving a unified approach, consistent approach that's practical, not just aspirational, and then to provide an ethical maturity graph, a visual way of representing how that progress is taking place. Because it's not enough just to aspire to an ethical approach for algorithms. It's time to take that next step to make it practical, to make it actionable, to actually have some kind of track record to all of these approaches. Because establishing and following an ethical standard for artificial intelligence before developing the technology or using this algorithm is essential. And in Tara's case, in Mrs. Simmons' case, the Supreme Court of Washington ruled in her favor that she had demonstrated a change in her life for the better. She made a clean break with her past. She was fundamentally different than she was before. In fact, the court in their decision published this quote you see on their screen. And as we embrace new technology and sources of data and assume that anything is predictable with enough data, we would do well to remember what they wrote. They wrote, "We affirm this court's long history of recognizing that one's past does not dictate one's future." In summary, past patterns in aggregate can be helpful, but we can't lose sight of the individuals involved in the systems we build. Lest we be seduced by the power and the potential of technology, we can't let it outpace our ethics. And that's why ethics is so key, so important. It's that ethical approach that allows us to use algorithms with our humanity intact. Looking forward to it, and see you at RSA this year. Thank you.